Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel. In grace my fears relieved. How precious did
Amen. Good morning, everyone. Or good afternoon. Wasn't that beautiful? As we get ready to go into the Word today, I want to invite you just to bow your heads with me as we pray. Father, we thank you for making us your beloved. And we ask that as we gather before you and open your word, that you would open our hearts by the presence and power of your Holy Spirit. We pray that you would show us your Son, Jesus, and his will for us, and then enable us by your power to walk in it. In Jesus' name, let all God's children say, amen. The late Paul Harvey, who was the host of the syndicated radio program, The Rest of the Story, once shared this true story about a little boy. He was about 3 years old, and his mother, who went to the grocery store. Now, this little boy had a little habit of always requesting chocolate chip cookies when they went into the store. And often when his mom didn't get him the cookies that he wanted, he would be, let's just say, quite unhappy. And so today his mom decided that she didn't want to deal with any of that. So she was going to give him a good speech before they went into the store. So she turned to her little boy and she said, listen, we're going in this store. And I want you to know from now that you're not going to get any chocolate chip cookies. So don't even ask. Do you hear me? The little boy said, yes, mommy. So she picked him up and put him in the cart and went into the store. And at first he was okay. He was quiet. He was sitting there. He was just looking around until something caused the mom to have to go into the aisle where the chocolate chip cookies were. And when he saw it, his eyes got big and he just couldn't help himself. He said, mommy, please, may I have some chocolate chip cookies? She said, I told you not even to ask. No, you cannot have any chocolate chip cookies. They left the aisle and they kept going through the store. But every time the basket would bring them even close to where the chocolate chip cookies were, he would ask again. And she would say again, no, you're asking me and you keep asking me and I'm going to keep on telling you, no, you're not getting any chocolate chip cookies. Well, finally, at the end of the shopping, when he knew that she was turning that cart towards the checkout counter, he realized that this was his last opportunity. So just as they were getting up to the cash register, he stood up in the basket and said, mommy, in the name of Jesus, may I please have some chocolate chip cookies? His mother was so embarrassed because everybody heard him and all of the other customers stopped and they looked up and they recognized what was going on and they saw the dilemma. But would you know that that day, that little boy and his mom, because of the kindness of the other customers, left that store with 23 boxes of chocolate chip cookies. That little boy knew something about the power of persistence. And there is something that we as believers can learn from him about this persistence, especially when it comes to prayer, and especially right now. We're going to be talking about that a little bit today in God's Word. We're using as a title, Praying at the End of Time. I want to invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 18, and I'll be reading in your hearing from the English Standard Version, verses 1 through 8. Luke chapter 18, and beginning with verse 1. It says, "And he told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. He said, in a certain city, there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, 'Give me justice against my adversary.' For a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, 'Though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming.' And the Lord said, 'Hear what the unrighteous judge says, and will not God give justice to his elect who cry out to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?" Luke begins his record of Jesus's parable by sharing the reason why Jesus told the parable in the first place. Jesus told this parable so that people would learn, men and women and boys and girls would learn to pray and not lose heart. That word lose heart could mean to lose one's motivation in continuing a desirable pattern of conduct or activity, to lose enthusiasm or to become discouraged. With that, Luke launches into this story that now is quite familiar to us about this widow who lives in a town where the ruling authority is a despicable judge. He is cold-hearted and mean, and he is shameless about it. He is a man without a conscience. He does not care what anybody thinks of him, not man and not God. This widow has an adversary who has been taking advantage of her. Maybe it's some sort of creditor or something like that. As a widow, she represents the most vulnerable and defenseless person in ancient society. She cannot work to support herself, and without the protection of a husband or a son or a brother or some other male relative, she is completely exposed. No one is there to defend her or to champion her cause. Her only recourse is to plead for justice from this judge who really could care less. At first, the judge refuses to help. But after a while, because the woman will not stop coming and will not stop pleading, he finally decides to help her. He says to himself, "Even though I don't fear any man and I don't fear God, even though I'm this heartless brute, I'm going to help this woman lest she continue to come and come and come and annoy me and wear me down." Really, the word picture in the original language is, "lest by her constant coming, she keeps beating me in the eye until it's black and blue." The unjust judge has all the power. The widow has absolutely no power. Yet her only power is to plead and plead and plead until the persistence of her pleas overwhelm the indifference of this shameless judge. And this is how Jesus is teaching believers to to pray. He calls us to pray with importunity. That's just an old English word for pray or to plead or to ask for something so much that you become annoying with your request. He's teaching us to pray with persistence, to be a pest in prayer, to be bold and shameless in our persistence. Jesus, by telling this story, uses the rabbinic teaching strategy of arguing from lesser than to greater than. In other words, what Jesus is saying is, if this wicked judge who doesn't care about anybody and could care less what anyone thinks about him is willing to give justice to this widow for whom he has no consideration, then how much more will not God, who is a just God, a righteous God, and a loving God, not give justice to his beloved elect children when they plead with him in prayer for justice and to be avenged? Will he not also give them justice as a result or in answer to their importunate praying? You see, importunate praying, persistent praying has power. But really, this story and its meaning is deepened, widened, amplified when we're able to consider it in its full context. Jesus is not just teaching that disciples should pray with importunity, with persistence. He's teaching that this type of praying should characterize the lives and the spirituality of believers or disciples who are living at the end of time. We know that he's talking about the end of time. The first clue is that at the end of his parable, he says, when the Son of Man comes. So we know that what he has in mind is who's going to be praying like this right before the time when Jesus comes, so that he finds them in this posture, this attitude, this practice of prayer when he gets here. And then he adds these foreboding words. He says, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith in the earth? In other words, in this context, he's calling this type of importunate praying faith. He equates this with faith. Those who have faith when Jesus comes are those who are praying like this. He casts doubt on whether or not he's going to find disciples or believers who are praying this way when he returns. The question is, will there be faithful Christians at the end of time who will be devoted to this type of intense, persistent praying? The end time context is not just what Jesus says when he says, when the Son of Man comes, but it actually begins in the section right before this story. When we have chapters and verses, sometimes it causes us to miss what happens before or what happens after, because we're thinking this is just about right here. But when Luke wrote this, there were no chapters or verses. He wrote it all together, and he wanted us or his audience to read this story in the context of what Jesus had just said. So we're going to read that so we can see how that helps us to understand what Jesus is driving home in this story. So now Luke 17 and beginning with verse 22, just a few verses before this. It says, Luke 17, verse 22, and he said to the disciples, the days are coming when you will desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and you will not see it. And they will say to you, look there or look here. Do not go out or follow them. For as the lightning flashes and lights up the sky from one end to the other, so will be the Son of Man in his day. See, he was just talking about the Son of Man coming. Then he goes on, but first he must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation, just as it was in the days of Noah. So it will be in the days of the Son of Man. You see, now he's talking about what it's going to be like at the end of time, right before he comes. They were eating and drinking and marrying and being given in marriage until the day when Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise, just as it was in the days of Lot, they were eating and drinking, buying and selling, planting and building. But on the day when Lot went out from Sodom, fire and sulfur rained from heaven and destroyed them all. So will it be on the day when the Son of Man is revealed. On that day, let the one who is on the housetop with his goods in the house not come down to take them away. And likewise, let the one who is in the field not turn back. Remember Lot's wife. Whoever seeks to preserve his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life will keep it. This tells us that disciples will come to a point where they will long to see the coming of the Son of Man. They're going to want it to come, but that coming is going to be delayed. But while they wait, they will be inundated with deceptive kingdom movements and false Christ. In other words, there's going to be the danger of false Christian movements that's going to threaten the spirituality of end time believers. But this is not it. Their faith will also be threatened by the spirit of the age in which they live. Jesus is saying that just as it was before the judgment of the flood and the judgment of Sodom and Gomorrah, so it will be before the final judgment of the world. There will be an intensity of focus on and preoccupation with the natural life and the material world. God and the things of God, including his approaching judgment, will be the farthest thing from people's minds. People will be completely engrossed with earthly priorities. And although none of these things that he mentions are sinful things in and of themselves, buying, selling, eating, drinking, building, planting, marrying, giving in marriage, none of them are sinful things in and of themselves. The sin will be that these things, these activities of the natural life, will be placed at the center of life, displacing thereby God and his Son, Jesus Christ. In other words, the material world will consume people's energy, activity, and focus. In this way, end time living will be characterized by idolatry, an idolatrous type of living. And here is the danger, not just the doctrinal threats of false Christ and false Christian movements, but the danger is that believers will get sucked in to the material focus of the end time world. That Christians will get caught up in natural living, eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, buying, selling, building, planting. Because of these things, Christians will be in danger of losing their longing for the kingdom and their antipathy for the adversary. End time Christians will be in danger of losing their sense of loyalty and devotion to God, his name, his will, and his kingdom. They will be at risk of forgetting that there is even an adversary. They will tend to forget that they are helpless and in constant spiritual danger. Therefore, they'll forget to think with the worldview that causes them to pray, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. They are in danger of forgetting to put their material needs and their natural lives within the proper perspective. What's that? Just give us this day our daily bread. Instead of a life that's characterized by eating and drinking and building and planting and buying and selling, not only preoccupied with these things, but also taking them to excess. Beloved, materialism and the natural life is such a serious threat to end time importunate praying because it has the power to distract us and change our focus and even our allegiance. I remember hearing a pastor talk about a time when he and his wife ran into an old acquaintance, a Adventist woman that they hadn't seen in years. And when they saw each other, they stopped for a moment and they started catching up. So she started talking about her life and her family, and they were, you know, just saying what had happened, transpired in their personal lives since the last time they've seen each other. But while she talked about her kids and her husband and so forth, her eyes lit up when she got to the topic of talking about the fact that right now, as they spoke, she and her husband were in the middle of building their dream house. And she's, oh, it's just wonderful. We got the best piece of land and we got a great deal and everything is working out. And she started talking about all the amenities they were going to put in the house and the view from the master bedroom and the type of countertop that she wanted to put in the kitchen. And you could just see how excited she was. She said, oh, it's so lovely. We're almost there. I just hope that Jesus doesn't come before we're finished and get to live in it. And just as she was saying that, she realized what she was saying, and she lifted her hand, and she put it over. Everyday life, all by itself. Not sinfulness. Not wickedness. Not immorality. Just everyday life. All by itself has the power to take our eyes off of Jesus and his kingdom. Not sinful things, just natural things. And that's the point. In some ways, the greatest threat to believers is not sin or not sin, but what's spiritually rooted in Christ versus what's natural. You remember the parable of the sower? In Luke, the thorns that crush out, that choke out the word, they're the cares of this life. Just the cares of this life. You know, what great am I going to get in this class? What college or university am I going to go to? What's my career going to be? Who will I marry? How are we going to pay these bills? How are we going to make ends meet? How can we make sure that we're planning and putting away just enough so that, you know, when we're no longer working, we'll still be able to do what we need to do? Where or when are we going to retire? Just the natural life. So Jesus warns, remember Lot's wife. Lot's wife was so much in love with Sodom that she did not even want to be saved when salvation came, because her heart was wrapped up in Sodom. Angels came to her house, no, into her house, grabbed her by the hand and pulled her out. But she preferred the enjoyments of her natural life to salvation. This fatal decision was immortalized by the rigid form of Mrs. Lot, cast in salt and sulfur, standing on the plains outside of Sodom, on the way to salvation, but looking back toward the doomed city that she loved. Now you might ask, what does all of this have to do with importunate praying? What Jesus is trying to show, and what Luke is trying to show by laying out this description of the end times, and then this parable of this widow praying at the end of time, is he's trying to show that this persistent widow praying is the type of praying that Christ is calling us to in the context of the end times. Not just importunate praying, but also the content of the praying and the mindset that's behind this type of importunate, persistent, intense praying. What do I mean by that? Notice that the widow is praying against her adversary. She is asking the judge to give her justice from her adversary. So if the judge stands in the place of God and the widow stands in the place of believers living at the end of time, then who does the adversary represent? The adversary represents the evil one and his agenda against the people of God and against God in this world. So to pray against the adversary is to pray against Satan and his kingdom and his rule and his agenda, to cry out, to plead, God, you've got to act. God, you have to bring this reign of evil and this madness and this violence and this wickedness to an end. You've got to eradicate sin. You've got to destroy death. You've got to judge wicked people and the evil one. It's to say, Lord, bring this to a close. This is what it means to pray against the adversary. And because our adversary is also God's adversary, when we pray like this, we're not only praying for ourselves, we're also praying on behalf of God. Because when we are avenged, at the same time, God will be vindicated. His kingdom will be fully ushered in. His name will be hallowed. His will be done on earth, even as it is in heaven. Praying in this way represents a preoccupation with God finally acting to deal a death blow to the forces of darkness. It is to pray for the great controversy to be brought to a close. It's a mindset of longing for the consummation. Luke illustrates this early on in his gospel with the story of Simeon and Anna, who are in the temple every day before the coming of the Messiah. And they're praying, and they're praying, and they're praying. Luke describes them as they were looking for the consolation of Israel. That's what their minds and their lives were focused on. And Simeon lingers in the presence of God over this so long that God says, you know what, Simeon, I tell you what, I'm not going to let you die before you're able to see the Messiah face to face. This is the picture of what believers should be like at the end of Earth's history. This is why Jesus teaches his disciples to pray the way he does in the Lord's Prayer. And then he teaches the disciples that when they have this type of focus on God, his name, his kingdom, when putting the spiritual life over the natural life and so forth, that this is how they should think. This is how they should think and pray in the end of time. And then now in this story, he's telling them, and you've got to keep praying like this, persistently, importunately,
Don't stop, even though it seems like your prayers are not being answered, even though it seems like nothing is changing, even though the more you pray, it's the more it seems as though it's going from bad to worse. Don't stop praying. Keep on praying. Then finally, at the end of Luke, Jesus describes this again while he's talking about the end of time. This is our last text. Luke now 21, 34 to 36. Now, this is Luke's version of Matthew 24, Sermon on the Mount. Not Sermon on the Mount, but Sermon on the Mount of Olives, where he's talking about the end of time, or Mark 13. So Jesus is talking about the end of time. Then after the end of talking about these signs, this is what he says in Luke 21 and beginning with verse 34. He says, "But watch yourselves." You hear that? Believers at the end of time, we're not just watching the signs and what's happening in the world. We're watching ourselves. He says, "But watch yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and cares of this life, and that they come upon you suddenly like a trap, for it will come upon all who dwell on the face of the whole earth. But stay awake at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are going to take place and to stand before the Son of Man." So at the end of saying everything that will happen at the end of time, Jesus now warns his disciples that they need to take heed to themselves, because they will be swept up in everything that's going on. Their hearts will become intoxicated spiritually. They will become drunken with the world. They will fall asleep. They will lose focus. He says, so watch yourselves and then pray that you'll be saved from all these terrible cataclysmic things that are coming. And then also pray that you will be saved from the greatest cataclysm of the last days, which is to be ready to stand before the Son of Man. Pray that you'll be saved when it comes to that. But it's this type of praying that makes it possible for that to happen. This type of importunate praying that prepares us for the greatest end time trial. Ellen White says in Acts of the Apostles, page 564, prayer is heaven's ordained means of success in the conflict with sin and the development of Christian character. The divine influence that come in answer to the prayer of faith will accomplish in the soul of the suppliant all for which he pleads: for the pardon of sins, for the Holy Spirit, for Christ-like temper, for wisdom and strength to do his work, for any gift he has promised, we may ask, and the promise is, ye shall receive. This is the type of praying that we're being called to right now. The mindset, the worldview, the lifestyle we're being called to right now. Not just praying, but praying. This is the key to victory in the last days. This is what will finally make us overcomers. We will be like Jacob beside the river Jabbok, wrestling with the angel, holding on to the angel, that is, holding on to Jesus himself, saying, I won't let you go until you bless me. I won't let you go until you change my name. This is the key. We don't get by because of willpower or an ability to do it. We get by because we recognize we have no power. We have no ability. All we have is a prayer. So we will cling to Jesus and we'll plead with him until he brings about in us all that he desires. So we've got to ask ourselves, am I praying like this? Is this my mindset? We've got to ask ourselves, where is my focus? Is it on the natural life or is it on the spiritual life? Jesus is calling us to a spiritual focus on him. Jesus is calling us to detachment, such a detachment that we're in the garage and the final crisis comes and we don't run back into the house to get anything. That's how detached we are. Jesus is calling us to lose our lives down here and to find our lives in him. And I want to answer his call. How about you today? I want to end today by just sharing briefly, very quickly, about how Luke brings this to an end in his gospel, because he's doing this on purpose. Luke talks about prayer in a way that no other gospel writer talks about prayer. And for Luke, the pinnacle of this type of praying, the ultimate model of this type of end time importunate praying, is Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. So Jesus getting ready to face the final trial for the gospel writers is a microcosm, a model, a picture of what it's going to be for believers living at the end of time. So Jesus facing the cross is us facing the final crisis. That's how they understand it. So when we see what Jesus does at that time, it's a picture of what we should be doing at this time. So as Jesus is arrested, before he's arrested, he knows what's coming. He's getting ready to go to the cross. It's the hour of greatest spiritual burden and emergency. What he does is he brings himself to his Father and he casts himself down and he begins to pray. He begins to pray with agonizing, fervent prayer. And he says, Father, if this cup can be taken from me, take it away. For the first time, we see daylight between the will of Jesus and the will of the Father. And that's deep. But then he said, but nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. But then the gospel writers say that after he prays that, he goes and he prays it again and again. What does that mean? That means that after Jesus prayed that prayer, the issue wasn't settled for him. He had not come to the place where his will was in alignment with his Father's will. And this is Jesus. So he realizes that the conflict is still there. The pull of my human nature to go my own way is still there. What am I going to do? I'm going to pray some more. So he importunes, Father, not my will, but yours be done. He prays this over and over and over until his will is finally brought into settled alignment with the will of the Father. And then he is ready to face Calvary. And this is how we overcome. It's not by a better schedule, a better list, more effort, trying harder. No, this is how we overcome. Through importunate praying. Not my will, but yours, until finally his will and our will are aligned. My favorite part of the story is an old ancient tradition that's included in verses 43 and 42 and 43, where 43 and 44, I think, where it says, while he's praying and he's doing this, he's so weak. It says an angel, a mighty angel, a big, powerful, glorious, robust angel comes and the angel strengthens him. And do you know what he does with that strength? It says, and being strengthened, he prayed more fervently. This is how important this type of praying is. This is how key it is. That the strength he gets from an angel, he doesn't get strengthened by the angel and say, okay, good, now I can do it. The purpose for the strengthening of the angel is to be able to persist in this type of praying until his will and the Father's will are aligned. This is what Jesus is calling me to and you to right now. I'm going to pray right now. I want to invite you to stand as we pray. You want to be a disciple who prays like this, then I just invite you to stand. But I'm also going to make two appeals. My first appeal is for the person who wants special prayer today. One, because you know what it is that Christ is trying to work out in your life to bring your will into perfect alignment with his. You know what it is. I know what it is. I'm standing up here already. And like I said in the sermon, oftentimes this is not about sin or not sin. Oftentimes it's about distraction. It's about focus and what's pulling our focus. But you want special prayer for whatever that is now. You want this prayer to be the beginning of your Garden of Gethsemane praying. That's you. I just want to invite you to come down as we pray. Won't you come? I want to be included in this prayer. Won't you come? Amen. And then, even as you come and we get ready to pray, and even as I start praying, anybody else that wants to come, feel free to just join us. And then, as we pray, I'm going to make another appeal. And so be ready for that. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you for your word today. We thank you for your son, Jesus, and for the victory he won on our behalf. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your promise to be with us even to the end of the age. And Lord, we feel and know and see and sense that we are at the end of the age. All hell is breaking loose, God. It's a dangerous world out there. And Lord, if it were only out there, it wouldn't be so bad. But Lord, the danger and the conflict and the terribleness, it's even within. Lord, we sense it in our own selves, in our own sinful natures. So we come to you today, Lord, pleading and asking for your intervention, pleading and asking, Lord, that you would bring us to the place where our will would be perfectly aligned with your will. Lord, we pray that you would teach us how to pray these importunate prayers. Lord, show us how to persist. Lord, strengthen us so that we can do it. Lord, we pray, oh God, for those who've come down. You know exactly why they're here. You know why I'm here, oh Lord. Lord, we've heard the call of your spirit, and you know the fullness that we want, the wholeness that we want, the consistency that we want. But how often, Lord, we're constantly derailed and distracted and taken away and knocked off course or whatever the issue is, oh Lord, you know. But Lord, not our will, but your will be done. Bring us into alignment with your will. Cause our wills to be merged with your will so that we can be one with you, that you may be glorified in us. Even as every head is bowed and every eye is closed, perhaps there's in the house today someone who hears the Spirit of Christ calling you to full surrender to Jesus. He wants all of you, and you've heard him calling for all of you. You want it, but you haven't known how to move in that direction because you know you don't have the power or the consistency. But you just want to say, yes, yes, Lord, not my will, but your will. If that's you, just raise your hand where you are. Just raise your hand where you are. Father, you see the hands and you know the hearts. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy and bring many sons and daughters to glory because you can. In Jesus' name, let all God's children say, amen. God bless you. You may be seated.